Hello everybody, let's get started. I will talk about suggestion and tools to progressively move towards the ideal world of a DevOps approach when you're so far from it that don't even think that's possible. So a few words about me. So I'm a software architect interested in Java, DevOps, and machine learning, working for Katamania in Luxembourg. So what's DevOps? DevOps is at the intersection of three domains traditionally separated: dev, testing, and operations. The challenge is to bring about the collaboration between these three worlds. What benefits can we expect from DevOps? The main ones are more reliable and more frequent deliveries. So how can we do that? Above all, it's an organizational matter. But if we can't change the organization, at least for now, let's focus on the technical view, which can be seen as automation and therefore infrastructure as code. And start demonstrating how a DevOps approach can make the world a better place. Because that's the point, or at least our workplace. There is a saying that goes, to live happily, live hidden. Sometimes it's true, but definitively not in your case. In order to be as efficient as possible, you should record and share everything. So applicative code, infrastructure code, log of each deployment, and all the monitoring data. This will allow the people who have the knowledge about the problem to help identifying and solving it. Suitable tools to do that will be Git for the code part and the wiki for the log of the deployment. From my experience and the feedback I had, this is a very important point in improving your efficiency, and even maybe the most important one. Here how things usually go in traditional organizations. When the dev team is ready to put something into production, they build a nice package and throw it over the wall to the ops team. The ops team has never heard of the project before, and the dev team won't have any detail if something goes wrong during the deployment and during normal operation. Everybody can see it won't work very smoothly. So, what can we do to improve this? We can try to mimic the nature which has usually found answer before us. In quantum mechanics, we can go through all using the tunnel effect. If we can change the organization, let's build tunnels below organizational walls using tools like Git or Ansible and demonstrate it improves the global efficiency. So here we are, Ansible. What is it and how can it help us? Ansible is a software that automates software provisioning, configuration management, and application deployment. So it's open source and free, built by a community supported by Red Hat. It's agentless, it requires only SSH and Python 2.6 or more. It can manage Linux or Unix machine and also Windows machine. On Windows target machine, it uses native PowerShell remoting rather than SSH. But your control machine needs to be a Linux one. It also have a parallel execution. I mean, if you have some operation to do on 10 or 1,000 of hosts, it will be automatically launched in parallel on all hosts by default. It's also easy to use. It uses a decentralized approach. There's a lot of built-in modules, to copy file, templating, package installation. At least there is 750 and more. It has a reusable and shareable world using Ansible Galaxy. So world is an elementary unit you can reuse in your playbooks. It has a pluggable inventory. So the inventory is a list of the hosts you want to manage. And any tools that can produce a text text file containing the list of your of hosts you want to manage and the host-specific variable you want to use can be plugged with Ansible. There is also a vault which allows you to encrypt sensitive data such as passwords using a single master password on the control machine. There are other great solutions supporting infrastructure as code, but the main advantage of Ansible are that it has no dependency on this agent list. So it's ideal for a progressive setup. On the other hand, if you talk about code, we need unit tests. And I must admit that it's not easy to do unit tests for your Ansible playbooks. Anyway, you can do integration tests. You will find a lot of examples online, and I can show you one of them. So let's say you want to install a Tomcat server on a bunch of machines. So you will launch the command Ansible playbook, passing the host file and the playbook you want to run, so the site.html. So if you look at the first at the inventory, so the host file, you will list your servers. Here we are only ones. You can add variables on each host and put them into groups. And therefore, you can also define the variable at group level. For example, here you have some port and some password, so we could encrypt this file using Ansible Vault so the password won't be in clear text in on the control machine. If you look at the playbook you are going to launch, so we describe, you specify the host. So here we put the host group, so all Tomcat server will connect as the root user, and we'll deploy the following role, is Linux and Tomcat. So if you go to roles. So SU Linux is a very simple one. I said Ansible has no dependency. In fact, you need in order to copy files on a machine which has SU Linux enabled, you just need a Python library which called libSU Linux by Python. But you can install it using Ansible. It's not really a big deal. So here we just install the EPUL and install this package using Yum. And then if you, for the installation of the Tomcat, so first we install a JDK and do a bunch of copy some files and you can, here we use the template module. So we are we'll put server.xml to a specific destination, but it's not to copy file. With template, you can replace a variable into your file. So yeah, here you have you can reuse the variables you defined before. So I didn't mention the syntax of the file is YAML. It's quite easy to write. There is also a nice concept of handlers. So here we have when we put this files, so Tomcat users, if the file has been modified on the remote host, if the file has changed, it will notify you should restart Tomcat. If the content is the same as before, the Tomcat won't be restarted. So in handler, we have the handler. When this handler is called, it will call the service command to restart the Tomcat service. Go back to task. Yeah. It's almost it. So we'll find a lot of comprehensive documentation on the Ansible website, and many examples in the community, which is quite important. As a conclusion, I would like to encourage you to use and support Firefox and Wikipedia. In my opinion, it's extremely important to keep them healthy and independent from commercial interest. Firefox is the only major browser engaged in personal data protection. You can support them through donation, but also through contributions to the code, or test, or contribute to articles, or things like that. And that's all. Thank you very much for your attention. A bit,